Okay, so I think we are live. So hello everyone, namaste. This is Saurav, and with me today I have Sharmila and Michelle. Today, before starting our talk or session, I just want to go through or rephrase some lines from Sir Ken Robinson. Unfortunately, we lost him last year in the month of August. I really follow Ken Robinson, and I really like his philosophies, his ideas about the, advanced or maybe the futuristic learning. कि future में क्या learning हो सकता है, किस तरीके से हम अपने बच्चे को और अच्छे से learning दे सकते हैं. And what he said is like three things that are very important as instruments of learning for children are like the diversity, the curiosity, and the creativity within children. Every child in this earth is very, very different, very diverse, and that is the uniqueness of every child. Every child is very curious, and that is how they learn. The third point is they are very much creative. That is how they create new things. So these are very, very good lines to thought upon. इसके ऊपर हमें सोचना चाहिए. और मुझे लगता है कि unfortunately the mainstream education or the mainstream school is not really doing good on these three things. So हमें उस पर सोचना चाहिए. And why I am starting today's session on these lines, because today we are going to talk something on the same lines, because Michelle is doing a excellent experiment on education, which is very much diverse, very different, and very creative. So we will start today's session with Michelle, and with me Sharmila is there. And during the session, as we always do, that if you have any question, if you have any query, you can put it up on the comment section, and we'll raise the question during our conversation, and we can have the answers. So I would like to over it to Michelle so that we can have an introduction from her about herself and about whatever she is doing. Over to you, Michelle.
Yeah. Hi. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for inviting me to this platform and giving me an audience. I have no background in education. I'm not an MA in education. I'm not a B.Ed. I have never taught. And I'm just here to share my both personal, professional journey. My personal and professional life are completely integrated. And education has become a big component of it for the last decade because of my own children and because of an institution that I ended up running. So I'm here today just to share about my life experiences, which have, education has become a big component of it. I grew up in the city in Bombay, and I spent 27 years of my life in the city, and now I've spent 20 years of my life in a village. And the 20 out of the 20 years in the village, 10 years is to do with education and tribal children. So this is my own both personal and professional journey. I have a set of slides about what the institution does. But just to let you know that I'm not running an institution from a distance or from a very professional point of view. Everything is very personal. My own children study in the same institution that I run. And this institution is located in a village. So it's all, the entire sharing is about how we ended up doing so much education, trying to understand education. And of course, in our case, particularly, we are located in a village and we are working with tribal children. So how did I get into education? I'm an MSW, and I was doing a lot of social work in the development sector. I was an activist, actually, a Greenpeace activist, an activist protesting against ports. And my background was there, but there was a desire to leave the city and a desire to, really live in a rural area and do some community development. And that's how I left Bombay. And I'm a typical Bandra girl, actually. Spent all my life in Bandra. And then now I live in a place called Sogwe, and moved here in 2002 and looked around, continued to do activism, but used to visit the local Zilla Parishad school, look at the condition of education, look at the tribal children, and, really see that how inequity is perpetuated through these institutions. Now, what happened is that in this journey, I obviously had my own two children, and then the question of educating them came up, And the question was, we are living in an isolated chikku farm in a village. And as I said, the mission was earlier to leave the city life, to, you know, bring meaning and quality to life, both by your living space as well as by the activities that you could do. And the city didn't seem to offer us that. So while we, you know, while we overcame the challenge of living in a rural area, we dealt with the snakes, we grew our chikkus, we had kids then, you know, and then the question of educating them came up. So the question was, how do we educate them? There are local schools, you know, we are not living in planet Mars. I mean, there are lots of schools around. There are convent schools, there are Zilla Parishad schools. But the question was that education system seemed to be wrong. It didn't work for us. Everything that I did in my life, you know, had to be taught through the job, through the work that you did, or through life experiences. So putting your own children, after having this alternative life, living in a chikku farm and, you know, being close to nature, working in the land, and suddenly having to put your children in a conventional school seemed wrong. So the idea of homeschooling came up, and this is why I'm sharing this story with you. But homeschooling at that time, as it is, we live in isolation. We live on a 15-acre farm, and the closest house is, you know, pretty far away. So as it is, we are quite isolated. So then the idea was that, what do we do? There were educators around us, people heavily into education, who said, you know, this is your time and opportunity. You have your own children. You must start a school of your on your own. And frankly, that was the start of an organization, an institution that is 10 years old, called Tamarind Tree. So we now run Tamarind Tree, which began because of our own two girls. And I'll share my screen and talk about Tamarind Tree and the work we do at Tamarind Tree. So Tamarind Tree is a little school in Sogwe village, Dahanu Taluka, 120 kilometers from Bombay. This is a tribal district where there are 60% of the population belongs to the Warlis, Dublas, you know, basically the marginalized scheduled tribe population. And we began this school We began the school in 2010. Of course, we are registered as a not-profit organization and so on. But our idea was that we want to redefine primary education. We want to do something that is not being done in education, to change the foundations, change the way the rote learning, the competitiveness, the grading, the inequity in the case of rural areas, the hierarchies, and the completely irrelevant curriculum that is being meted out to children from any kind of background. We wanted to change that. We didn't know what we wanted to do. We just knew that what's happening in regular schools is wrong, and we need to build an alternative model. So we started that. Somewhere in the back of our mind, technology was a critical part of this exercise, because we, prior to running the school, were into open source technologies. We were into Linux. We were into using. We were into resisting the proprietary control of technology and using, you know, open source technology. So somewhere in the back of our mind, when we started the school, there was also the idea that, how will we use technologies. So currently we have a school. I'll just go a little slow. Yeah. So just to give you very quickly, I don't want to get into this kind of thing, but we still have 30 million children out of school. We still have a curriculum that's redundant. And, you know, we are living in areas where children go to schools looking like this. And in the case of marginalized communities where we are, where we work and where we live, the inequity is even further accentuated because of the intergenerational differences. They are all first generation learners. There is no reading material at home. There is no exposure. So when we started the school, the idea was also, how can we offer higher quality education to the immediate population, which is the tribal children? The Zilla Parishad schools even today are, you know, in a very bad, poor condition. The teachers come with a lot of prejudice against tribal children. The language is foreign. Even if the schools are in Marathi, the tribals actually, the mother tongue is actually Warli, and so on and so forth. So we set up, we started in 2010, and we did the regular activity-based learning. We had songs, we had music. We started with pre-primary, and we decided to move, you know, to take it as it comes, to look at the learner, see the learner's needs, and then move ahead. And from 2010 to 2020, we basically moved more and more and more towards having technology right from very young age. And we became part of what is called the global open source movement for education. It's the open education movement that says that every child anywhere in the world, irrespective of their background, their caste, their culture, their economic background, their gender, they have a right to high quality education. So we became part of this global open education movement, which not only says that, but which actually then works to providing high quality education using only open educational resources. And I'll come to that a little later. So currently the school has 125 children from pre-primary to grade 8. And we are looking at doing the NIOS for grade 10. We are a government recognized, Maharashtra government recognized private school. We are not entirely free. We charge a small fee from parents, and parents, you know, happily contribute to this. We opted to go for English as the medium of instruction for tribal children, even though they were from a tribal background, because we realized that all new knowledge, all new science, all new, I mean, the entire new modern digital world is entirely operating in English. And if we want to build equity for these children, then, you know, having a school in the medium of instruction, in the language of English, would really build equity. So we provide meals, as you can see in the picture. We are located on a chikku farm, so children have enough of opportunity to do farming. They do karate and other kind of activities. And it's a kind of a holistic development where the nutrition program is very critical. We eat together, we provide locally, you know, local nutritious food sourced from the local area, which includes an entire meal, and all the needs of the children are basically looked after in this campus. The technology bit is the most important, but I'll come to that later. These are some of the images of our children sitting under the trees, doing some study. This is how our classroom looked. So when we talked about an open education model, how do we actually, what is the pedagogy and what do we do in the school? What we do in school is when the children enter, when they're 4 years of age, between 4 and 6, we have mentors, we have facilitators or teachers, whatever you call them. And they are guided through song, dance, and the computer to basic introduction to basic maths, introduction to basic science. The only difference is that we use open hardware on the campus. So we have single board computers and we have only open education resources. So we use an ecosystem of softwares, application games, and tools that are not in the proprietary domain. So for instance, we have, instead of Windows, we have Linux, or we have, you know, Debian as our operating system. So children engage with a completely different OS. And if we have games, we have TuxMaths, TuxPaint. These are all game softwares, platforms released in the open source domain by programmers anywhere in the world. Now I'll take a pause to explain to you what is open source and why you as a homeschooler or as somebody concerned in education should worry about open source. What is happening in education is that there's an increasing commodification of schools, of content, of, you know, the entire education stream, where the student and the learner has become a consumer and education is commodified as a commodity to be transacted. Now, this is very dangerous for any part of the world, but particularly for India, when we have so much of inequity, illiteracy, and a huge gap basically between people who are getting a good quality education. Education needs to be seen as a public social good, which needs to be provided technically and ideally by the state to the population, free of cost, high quality, with all possible digital resources. So as the privatization of education is creating problems, when you have paid apps, paid platforms, proprietary controlled resources, technology that is owned by corporations, large corporations, small corporations, you are increasing the right to children or the right to any learner to access high quality education. On the other hand, you have digitization, which is a great equalizer and which is providing opportunities to children to access the modern world. But the proprietary nature of education is scary, is frightening, and our work in Tamarind Tree and as part of the global movement is to oppose any kind of commodification and control of resources, digital platforms, technologies, and use only those that are in open source. Now, this is very important to understand and to be, you know, to digest, because many of you as consumers today are flooded with lots of technological options for your children. And more often than not, these platforms, softwares, games that you use are proprietary and they are not part of the open source domain. And you are contributing to becoming a disempowered consumer when you use these products. So having said that, what do we do in the school? We have an open source hardware. We have Raspberry Pis on the campus. And then the children engage with some ready tools, like, you know, games and so on. But when they are 7, they log into our own learning management platform, which is hosted on the open source Moodle. And children are basically engaging with their NCERT driven courses, which come through the LMS. So the LMS is rich. It's got quizzes, assignments, pages, HTML5 presentations, videos, and children consume content in an interactive and not entertainment manner. And there are mentors on the campus who then observe what these children are kind of doing. This is some more pictures of our campus. We also provide food. These are the little ones. So basically, the Tamarind Tree, as I said, has been like a laboratory for us, where we test out all these ideas in open technologies. We have a learning management system, a host on Moodle, which is our own, it's our own server and children login. It's called mybigcampus.in. And we have our own virtual conferencing platform where we take live class. That's on another open source tool called Big Blue Button. And then we develop our own content on these platforms and release them in the public domain, contributing back to the open education movement. So as I said, what are the solutions that we have? We have MyBigCampus, which is a website. It's a learning management platform where every learner, every volunteer, every teacher, every student has a login. They log into this platform and they can access their courses asynchronously as well as take live classes. For live classes, we have an open virtual class platform, and this is all driven by open source. The servers are owned by us. There is no proprietary company managing these servers. There is no IT department of some, of Zoom or anything else that manages our servers. We do all the server management ourselves. And we have, for the live classes, we use something called the Big Blue Button. This is our live class platform, which we have released in the pandemic, actually. And in addition to both these platforms, which are in the open source, we have openly licensed courses and content, which are part of these platforms, which we release again in the open source, and they are completely free, and students and teachers are able to use them. In addition, we also have a basket of hardware solutions which may be useful. So this is a Raspberry Pi. It's a very hardy, robust single board computer with no moving parts. It withstands voltage fluctuation in villages like ours, and it's a very nice computer for students to learn. It has certain programming tools already incorporated in the software, and built on that, we built our own operating system called TreeBN, which is a derivative of Debian, and this is how the students engage. This is our learning atmosphere, and we have Raspberry Pis on the campus. We have an e-library on campus. Unfortunately, the campus is shut, but in the e-library, we have about 4,000 to 5,000 books that are hosted, and students can open an EPUB reader on their machines here and read the books freely. You can also read it on any mobile device and so on. And we have in this TreeBN OS, we have our own operating system. We have our own games, our own tools, which have been either released in the open source or children access it through the LMS. So this is what we have. And we basically believe that we are catering mainly to underprivileged and marginalized children. That is 125 of our own tribal children, as well as other children who use our platform. And we believe that high quality learning should not be a privilege. It should be open and accessible to all. Just to share, that's what happens on the campus prior to the lockdown. And in the lockdown, what we did is that we've opened up our platforms. My Big Campus was opened up to children pan-India as well as to volunteers. And we now have a robust volunteer training program where volunteers take classes along with our own teachers. Volunteers take classes, and children from anywhere in India can log in, join the classes, access live classes, as well as access asynchronous content. So this is our School Without Walls project, where we're saying that children from any background should be able to access good quality content. We are restricted to some extent to continue with syllabus oriented courses because the children expect these, and we also need to deliver certain syllabus oriented ones. So we have English, science, maths, but we've had stuff on digital media, we've had stuff on financial literacy, we are now launching one on economics. And the model is that while live class is one component of the entire learning, it's only a small part of the learning. The students come like this online. This is a trainer. After the class, basically, the LMS provides the student a huge amount of opportunity to do a quiz, to do an assignment, upload a photograph, upload images, write down something that they feel, conduct an experiment at home, write down the results. So the asynchronous learning is also very important, and it generally happens after the live class. So it's a live class followed by other kind of activities on our LMS for the students. You'll be, you know, interested to know that most of the students are joining in on mobile devices, and we run a strong volunteer program, and we've done a huge amount of courses for these children. We've had children from all over, you know, from all over India, as well as from different brackets. We take children from 6 years to about 15 years, and we've had children in this lockdown from definitely from Maharashtra, because we are Maharashtra based, but from different parts of India, who have joined our platform and who are taking these classes. So one was the physical campus, which we continue to run, and hopefully it will open. But our vision is that MyBig Campus becomes an open learning platform, and is already, but expands as an open learning platform for children in the ages of 6 to 16 years all across the country. And volunteers who are committed, they have domain expertise. We have chartered accountants talking about, you know, money. We have graphic experts talking about photography. So we want volunteers to come on board, and we are getting a lot of volunteers to take courses and create content for children, so that children have both a live mentor as well as asynchronous learning. So this is just some additional slides that, you know, where do we take our content from, and how do we design our content. Essentially, the content building is, the NCRT is not the Bible. It's just used as a guideline to build on topics. And most of the time we are telling the volunteers and the teachers to go far, far, far beyond the NCRT syllabus, to use the NCRT syllabus only as a starting point. And our volunteers need to have domain expertise and knowledge. They need to be able to engage with children, and they need to have good digital skills. And one of the reasons I'm, you know, stressing on this is, if any of you would like to volunteer with us, then it would be really nice to see how we are, you know, widening this base of there being no B.Eds or D.Eds or necessarily trained teachers, but anyone in the new modern world can actually engage with children through platforms like this. So I just like to stop here. These are not some relevant slides. I'd like to stop here and you know, keep it to a little bit more sharing, because I'll get into nitty gritties and losing the point maybe. I think the idea is that how do we redefine education? Who is a teacher today? Who is a learner? Is the teacher a learner? Is a learner a teacher? You know, so those are some of the questions that we have been trying to answer through our model. And is there anything as too much technology? What technology should I use? How do I choose technologies for my child? How do I create a self-motivated learner? And how does the child then go and access? Because learning is no longer about content delivery, right? I mean, there is enough of content. And I'm sure we're talking to an audience that is privileged, that has access to enough of content possible, but still sometimes we find that children don't learn necessarily with access to content. So how do you create a learning culture? And I mean, our campus was one of those places, and technology was, for us, was just a tool to use to create that culture. Technology was not the end in itself, but it could really, like, we could really break the classroom hierarchy. Like, by class 5 and 6, we have no children and teacher in a classroom format. Everyone's sitting on their machines, they're doing what they have to do, and teachers are necessarily just looking at the back end of the performance of quizzes of students, the back end of, like, so what is technology providing us today? And teachers are then going and just saying, okay, Saurav, you didn't perform very well, you got only 7, or you didn't answer this, you know, your essay answer was really poor, can you rework on it? So giving pointed help where the child requires, not generally talking to like 20 children at one time. This is where technology helped us, because we are still an institution. It's not a homeschooling. There are 100 children on campus. It's a small number, but you know, there are still the numbers. So I think I'd like to keep it more question and answer based, and you know, take it from there. Or we can have a discussion, yeah.
Yeah. So one thing that was coming in my mind during, you know, the presentation is that, and if I can brief it down, is that Tamarind Tree is like a school serving to the marginalized children, and the curriculum that is being followed is NCRT. Based on the NCRT syllabus, you are creating educational contents which are there on the system and which can be accessed by anyone from anywhere. And there is also the voluntary based classes that are going on from your side, where the volunteers are from also anywhere. People can participate as volunteers, and children who want to learn on different subjects can also log into yes. that same website, and the interaction can happen. And this yes. entire thing is happening on voluntary basis, so there is no fees, there is no money involved.
For the courses, no. We keep up, our platform is entirely free. The children, like right now, we are just at 4 o'clock launching a course on soil. So anyone, like if we have children from all over who have applied and registered, and they can access 7 sessions, which means they get access to the LMS, the learning management platform. They get access to the mentor. They get access to the content put up in the platform, including a field assignment that go outside and, you know, check the quality of your soil or whatever testing, as well as the presentations, videos, and explanation, and a facilitator along with it. So it's not only asynchronous content like Udemy, which is, you know, you have 4.5 hours of video or so and so, where there's no live facilitator. We think for children, live facilitation is very critical. There is to be a mentor who says, like, boss, you know, the next class you better be doing this and coming. To that extent, we think children do need to be still guided. So there's a live class with a live mentor, which will happen, say, for 1 hour. After the class, the child has to engage and mull over what that class was about through set of activities given to him or her. So two things happen. One is a live mentoring, like you're replacing that one-on-one interaction with a human being, which you need. But you're saying that's not enough. I need to go back and then I need to solve that problem myself. I need to figure out, I need to think about soil and, you know, what I understand of it, and write down something or do something or test it or touch it or whatever. So that is done through the LMS.
Okay. Okay. And since you have been dealing with technology and education, so these questions comes a lot of time while we talk about, you know, during the pandemic, children are engaging in technology for their learning purposes. So how important is technology, and keeping in mind the future also, and what is the best suitable way for children to, you know, or parents to give their child technology based learning? What is the good way? I mean, there is a lot of confusion. If you can give your perspective on this.
So I think that there's a lot of fear. There was fear when the VCR was released in the society. There was fear when the television came in the society. There was a lot of anxiety around the ill effects of any technology. So we believe that there are ill effects like addiction and, you know, isolation and socially in a lack of aptitude to have social interactions. But we think that these are very extreme cases. If the child is being brought up in a normal, regular atmosphere with sufficient analogous experiences of the kitchen, of the outdoors, of a normal life like you and I have, then technology can only harness and only build on the child's knowledge. And we are very much pro the use of technology, because we see how in our own lifetime, the number of things that we have had to learn and can learn, and the kind of access to knowledge, information, skills that we are getting with the new technologies and the democratization of the internet, there is no way that you can stay out of it in that sense. Now, the question is, what is the direction of the technology? How do you make the right choices? We tell, even for tribal children, you'll be surprised that 4-year-old children come to the school and children, my parents say they're watching too much YouTube. What do we do with them? This is 4-year-old tribal children, right? I mean, who you're all, people are crying out loud that there is no access. But you'll be surprised that the PUBG and the YouTube is happening in rural areas as much as it is happening in urban areas. So the question then is that if we lack imagination of how we want to direct our children, it's not the child's fault, right? We have to have the creativity and the imagination of using the technology in the correct manner to produce something. One of our bylines in this technological, in this space has been that let us be producers of content. Let us be producers of knowledge. Let us not be consumers of knowledge. When I produce a small work of art, when I produce a video, when I produce a poster, when I produce a written work, when I produce anything, I'm producing knowledge. Let us use those tools and those interfaces, those softwares, those applications, which encourage children and adults to produce something. So one of the reasons we introduced the learning management system in our school was that teachers had to learn to produce content from scratch. teachers had to say, I'm a learner. I need to create a GIF image. I'm a learner. I need to create an HTML5 presentation that moves and that has audio in it. I need to learn to create. So this is the modern world of production, not of consumption. Proprietary tools encourage you to be consumers. Facebook encourages you to be a consumer. Certain other apps, Google will not encourage you to question the platform, how the platform works, what is the ownership of the platform, right? You will become a disempowered consumer of content or apps or platforms when you do not want to be a producer yourself. So the way to look at technology is that, can I set this up myself? Can a community around us set this up themselves? Is it such rocket science that only Facebook, Google, and Baiju's and Vedantu can own such technologies? Cannot community members themselves, cannot a homeschooling initiative, cannot My Big Campus, cannot Tamarind Tree also own the platforms that we use and also put them out for use for public consumption, rather than them being always technologically corporate controlled? So when you use a platform, you must ask your child also, do you know who has developed Minecraft? There is also an open source version of Minecraft called Mindtest. Do we know about Mindtest? There's also a place in Mindtest where you can develop your own mods, you can run your own servers. There are open source programmers who are mind testers, who are gamers. They create their own server. So they are doing something for the society. They are creating a server in which you can produce and build your blocks and build your houses, right? Versus Minecraft, which is a paid game, which I'm procuring from Microsoft or from wherever, and I'm installing it and then making my child do it, versus telling the child, can you create what you see in Minecraft? If you are playing PUBG, can you create the 3D character that you are seeing on the video game? What tools do you require to create these characters? So there is nothing wrong in the modern environment today. There are, even gaming for that matter. Can we create environments like that? Who are the people creating these things? So the question you must always ask your child when they're using any tool or when you offer any technological tool, does it encourage you to be a producer of content, a producer of something, or is it only encouraging you to consume, like YouTube, for instance? Okay, these are some very critical questions that I think as homeschoolers, we must always ask and question the platform and app before we opt for it.
True. Sharmila, you have something? You are on mute.
You're on mute, yeah.
I've been taking in a lot what Michelle has been saying, and I can resonate with so many things, because it's been about 4 years since we started unschooling, in fact, where we don't really do any academic, organized academic work with our children. And my children basically follow their heart. My daughter, who's 6 and a half, has suddenly surprised me by reading, and she's reading books, and I'm like, where did you learn? She says, I learned on the internet when I'm navigating through Google,
right,
or YouTube, or playing game, reading stories on Khan Academy Kids, or so they have the audio and the video, and then a lot of things.
Correct.
That she's been doing. And that really gets me to see that, open source education, where a lot of quality education is easily accessible to many, and where parents do not have to worry about, paying the subscription or getting into the competition. No, this is better than this one. Oh, my friend has joined this one, so I need to
join
that one and this one. And, end up unnecessarily spending their money as well as efforts and time. And, they could be doing a lot of other things with their children instead of just going through different paid subscriptions and paid programs. So I definitely feel that open source education is a real blessing to us. And yes, there were many questions around how do children do hands-on things. you know, when they're
Right.
constantly on the laptop or they're constantly glued to a screen learning things. It's not something where they are experimenting, sensing, using all their senses to grasp and learn. So, in fact, that was one of my questions because there are...
Yeah, I'd like to disagree with that. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. I just have to disagree with that, actually, because this is, again, a popular misconception. If you look at some of the new realities for young children today who are, you know, digital natives, as we see, they don't see their life as distinct from... their day-to-day, normal life, your physical reality as distinct from your digital reality. So I'd like to again take the example of this game called Mind Test or Minecraft, what you see. And you have to understand that you are using many, 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 many faculties of the brain, from your visual, spatial, 3D skills to all kinds of... So touch is okay. I mean, I guess you can't touch the block, but other than touch, the kind of faculties that you are using, sometimes even the touch won't give you so much of, multiple stimulation. So I think I'm not exactly explaining it well, but there is a misconception that children need to only, without the touch or without all the senses being used, you will not have a proper upbringing. In fact, I think if you look at some of the higher end softwares, which if the child is trained slowly, slowly as they grow older, say 12, 15, 16 years old, not so young, they require a heavy amount of mathematics, science, and visual observational skills. So if you're not a good observer in life, you haven't observed enough, you will not be able to use those tools. If your basic maths and science or your physics is not right, then 3D tools like Blender, for instance, you cannot use. So obviously, you've had to have a full overall holistic life to be able to even use these tools well. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, as I said, you're back to becoming a consumer. If your observation, like your day-to-day observation of things around you, whatever it may be, is not high, you cannot play these games well. And sometimes these games are helping you improve your observational skills. So I think that we should not have a binary of technology versus no technology, or digital life versus analogous life. We should not have these binaries. They are all completely overlapped today. I mean, I'm talking to Sharmila and I'm connecting. I saw your child in the background, right? I mean, I can sense what kind of homeschooling life you're having, and this is because of the screen. We would have never met otherwise. So I think we need to not get into these binaries of this is an adda, right? You guys have created an adda. We are hanging around, we are chatting. So We have also broken the barriers, the physical barriers of space, because of technology. Three of us today can sit here and chat. Only my cup of tea is in my hand and your cup of tea is in your hand. I mean, it's phenomenal what digitization can do, right? And we are sitting in a village, and have village kids to be able to access this kind of tools, to be able to play these kind of games, or to even do, like, for instance, all our children do Khan Academy maths. Okay, the kind of quality. Now, I'm not saying they're all great at maths. That's not the point. I'm not even saying that they all love it, but the way, the kind of the quality of the content that they are able to get, and it's building one over the other. There's class one maths, and there's class two, there's class three, there's class four. There are good quality videos. There's tons of practice quizzes. They don't need a teacher around them at all. Without any teacher, young tribal children can do integers or can do exponentials or can do fractions just by listening in and practicing. We are breaking boundaries of what education means and what education is. And this is because of one guy who decided to do this. So we don't need the Googles and Facebooks of the world. The whole technology is empowering, because you can see more and more empowering examples. As I said, even us chatting like this and just sharing our experiences is possible today because of this kind of a thing. And, so I think parents should, first of all, not get worried about this competition and this app and that app. The more popular the app, the less you should try it out. I mean, the more marketing around an app, like, seriously, just take my word of advice. The Shah Rukh Khan ad, don't touch that app. Look at the kind. I mean, these are MBA guys selling you education. I mean, they are telling you what is gravity and what is electricity, as if you don't know yourself, or as if you can't find out yourself. You need Baijus and Vedanta you have to pay them to tell you what is how electricity is generated. The whole thing is ridiculous, right? And you want Shah Rukh Khan to tell you that Baijus is good. It's a capitalism scam. There is no two ways about it. Please do not touch sites like White Hat Junior, which is enough has been said about, Byju's, Vedantu, Topper. They are perpetuating the competitive education politics that a homeschooler should be running away from, or that educators like us run away from. We don't even want to give that SSC exam. If there's any way that they just give the child the certificate, we are happy. Right. I mean, we know that the SSC or NIOS or whatever is a complete farce. I mean, the examination is, even you and I might flunk if we have to suddenly decide to give that exam right now. If overnight I tell Saurav Chal, you know, 10 week ka exam de do. You just look at the content and the syllabus, correct? So as homeschoolers, we need to shy away from anything, run away actually from anything that's conventional, anything that's capitalistic and driven by high budgets and marketing, and question them. You cannot teach your child coding and have somebody doing coding at 6 years. It's ridiculous. The idea is ridiculous. People take years and years and years to learn a PHP or a C or, you know, a language, and these people are sort of marketing. So I think if homeschoolers fall into this trap, then we are doomed. Because, right. You know, no, really, Sharmila, I mean, if homeschoolers can fall into this trap, then there's nothing left, because we are the people who are saying we don't want the mainstream, right, Saurav? We are the people who are saying we want to run away. Then we are getting swayed and becoming consumers of Byju's and Vedantu. We should be outrightly saying that these are bad.
Right. And there is another point, which is like most of us don't know the alternatives. I mean,
correct.
We know about Khan Academy, but I doubt how many parents know about Khan Academy. I doubt how many parents know about StoryWeaver. I doubt how many parents know the alternative of Minecraft. So that is why this kind of discussions are so important, to come up with, you know, ideas of alternatives. You know, there are alternatives available, better meant for your children, better, I mean, from all the perspectives. So if we go a little deeper into OER, like how parents will get access to OER.
See, I think one or two tips I clearly gave. Please stay away from the market glitzy, glamorous apps with a barge pole. Like, just stay away from them unless you're playing the same competitive games. You're giving IIT and IIG, whatever those all those IITG exams and all that, and you're going the same route. Then you have to go into the rote learning and so on. So, if you're just letting your child be, as Sharmila says, and evolve and emerge as they are emerging and learning on their own, then you can. If you go to Google or you go to any proper search engine, you can type open education resources. Gaming, open education resources, reading, open, you know, OERs, you can type stuff like that. So there is an international site called PHET simulations, PHET simulations, which are very high-end science and math simulations for class 6, 7, 8. It's developed by University of Colorado. They are very good quality simulations. And then there's, of course, Khan Academy. There is StoryWeaver, which allows you to not just read books, but also write your own books and upload and translate and so on. And then there are plenty of other Linux-based. There's a KDE environment in which there are Hangman, K-Geography, J-Fractions. So you have to basically get into that ecosystem, and you have to always understand, before Saurav asked me only, I will answer. You have to always understand that this is not mainstream. Open source is equally mainstream. 95% of the internet today is driven by open source servers. Okay, most of what you do, whether it's your Aadhaar or it's your income tax or it's your vaccination today, all the servers are actually open source. Open source is today good business. It's not something that geeks do. It's not something that, you know, only happens by philanthropic bodies or something like that. Moodle is a company that is an open source company. Red Hat is open source. Ubuntu is open source. Khan Academy is open source. And these are all profit-making, I mean, sustainable companies and organizations releasing products in the open source domain. It's just that they are not controlling the source code. So you need to get into that ecosystem very, very slowly. Like, as I said, there is an answer for every closed source product. There is an open source one already there. So if you're doing Photoshop with your children, then there is GIMP in the open source world. If you're doing Maya for 3D, there is Blender in the open source world. And once again, just let me tell you, these open source worlds have larger communities around them because nobody owns the product. So for instance, the Blender community, which is 3D, or the WordPress community, for instance, if you want to build your own world, website and you look at WordPress as an open source platform, then it has thousands and thousands and thousands of developers constantly improving the product. It's a collaborative knowledge building. So the open education movement says, let's build knowledge collaboratively. Let's not have a hierarchy that Michelle is telling you how this game is built. But let all three of us together build the game together. So this collaborative idea is also very powerful. It has been there in open source. So as I said, it's, you know, and if you look at WordPress, you look at Moodle, you look at Joomla, you look at a lot of these, lot of the things that are currently very popular on the internet, they're all open source. So always know that there is a community to back me. There is a world out there that I can rely on, just like you have guys have built an open homeschooling community. The open source community is far wider than the proprietary community, far wider, far bigger. It's just that you have to get into it and you have to not be worried that I'm gone into some alternative space and I'm going to forget how to do Windows and I'm going to forget about Bill Gates. There's nothing like that. You can merge between the two worlds very easily. For all your Microsoft Office applications, even today at home in your personal computers, instead of Word, Excel, and PowerPoint, there is LibreOffice. For every LibreOffice file, you can, if I know that Saurav is not an open source user or Sharmila is not an open source user, I can save the file as a .doc or a .pptx and send you. But if I know that you're an open source user, then I can save it in new formats, which are .odt, .ott, .so and so forth. So the open source world is always open to the closed world. All your files will save in this format. You can go between both the worlds. Nobody will know that I'm using an open source desktop right now, right? So because you will receive files and you will get everything as per the format you require. So you're not hiding away, or you're not, fear of missing out. FOMO, they say, the fear of missing out. There's no fear of missing out on anything. You're very much part of a wider community. And it's, I think, only if you as a parent begin that your child will then take on these ideas.
Right, right. Michelle, since you are in this open source area working from India, can you give some more examples from our country who are working in this way?
So there are, in education, there aren't that many. I mean, you already mentioned there are a few, like, so Creative Commons is a global organization that allows you to license your work through Creative Commons licenses, whether it's a piece of art or it's a music or so on. In India, other than a few of us, Saurav, there are a lot of people doing work in other fields other than education. In education, people, one of the problems is that educators think that they are only users of technologies. They think that technology kisi aur ka kaam hai, hamara kaam hai hi nahi, hum logo sirf usko use karna hai. This is one of the fundamental reasons why educators are not shaping the way technology is being developed, but they're just consuming it, they're just using it. So if you ask a school, they say, we are heavily into technology. What do you use? We use Google Classroom, Google Apps, Google this, Google that, the entire ecosystem. And when you ask them that, aren't you worried that your children's data is going directly to Google and Google is only seeing you as a data point, as you know, for analytics, for algorithms to be able to bombard you with advertisements and to steal your personal data? They are not yet understanding how serious this issue is. So educators and education, there are in higher education, for instance, there are a lot of universities in India, a lot of colleges that use Moodle as an LMS. But in schools, we don't find them using LMS. They are going into Zoom and WhatsApp and those kind of proprietary platforms. So education sector is still a native, nascent sector. There's not as much happening as there should be.
Okay. And like if I say, for example, like from my perspective, I am a very bad resource creator for my child. I have to think a lot to create an activity. So if I get some activity from the open source, and if I change it according for my child, and then after his time, say, for example, he's right now 4 years old. So I design a game, a learning game for him. Then he goes to, 5 years of age. Then what will happen to that? Because normally what we do, we try to find someone who can use it. But in case of tech-based such things, what to do with that resource.
No, in case of tech based, so it's fantastic because you can release that resource anywhere on your website or on any kind of platforms that are there, and release it under a CC BY SA, which is a share alike license. You know, where whatever I do, you can use it, you can reuse it, customize it, change it, appropriate it, and just give me credit. So, in fact, that is what the Open Education Resource Movement is saying, that all over educators, homeschooling parents, teachers, creators, computer programmers, they should create things and release this in the open source domain with this kind of license so that they can be reused. So, for instance, like going back again to a Khan Academy, they are releasing the videos. You can download those videos, translate them into your languages, and put them in your school for your use. So if you create a learning game and you make sure that it is in public domain, or you're allowing it to be reused, because it's a technological thing, somebody can take the entire game and reuse it and make it into a new game and release it again. This is the charm of the open education movement, that we take a ready resource or we take ready images and create our own slideshows, for instance, and release it again into the. So textbooks become irrelevant because you constantly are able to change content. You're constantly able to make videos or slideshows or presentations or books, digital books, which have a video embedded and an audio embedded. And that book, like if for instance, if my science teacher creates a book on soil today, I can release that book in the open domain, and somebody using Moodle can take that book and put some slides or some videos appropriate to their area for soil, for the discussion on soil. So this is the collaborative knowledge building that open source says, that I'm not dependent on one textbook, I'm not dependent on one corporate company, I'm not dependent on one syllabus, but I have a topic, I have an idea, I have a concept, I have a subject, I can build content, I can build digital resources, release them, and they can be reused, reappropriated, remixed. Those are the 6 R's actually of the open education movement, and released back into the open source domain. But most people are afraid. They think that we are not creators. We cannot create. Most educators, parents, as you're saying, they are scared. They're only trying to look for resources for the children. Resources are made by somebody else, but you can make your own resources. You can be a producer, and whatever you produce, your child will value and enjoy. It's like you sit and paint together, right? Often you paint rubbish, but the child is still enjoying painting with you. So similarly, you can create a digital resource. You don't have to make glamorous Byju's kind of content. You just make a small resource and you see, because you know the learning level of your child. You know in what context you can start that video. You have a topic and you know that this discussion has already happened with the child. So your video can start with that discussion. And that video may be relevant for another 5, 6, 7 parents. But most of the time, we are afraid that we can't be creators. We think that it requires a studio and it requires anchoring and it requires good quality video. But there's nothing like that. I encourage every homeschooler to think about becoming producers of knowledge for their own children. Becoming producers, tinkerers, playing around with things, creating things, not necessarily only digitally, but even physically.
True, true. We have got few comments, although maximum of them are from Bhagwanji. He is following quite closely. There is okay. One thing that he is saying is that he's asking to stay more on open source, free versus the free version of proprietary softwares. So,
yeah. No, so free version of proprietary software is a big no-no. We are hardcore open source evangelists. We will touch only software that is released, that the code is released in the open source, not proprietary software that you are pirating or you are getting free from somewhere, not paying for it. Because that is a violation, actually. And for instance, Tinkercad, I'm not sure, but AutoCAD, if you don't use the... Tinkercad is free to use, but it's not free from the open source. See, free to use is very different from free as in open source free. Free to use, maybe I'm free to use it, but I'm not free to change the code. I'm not free to change, adapt it. I'm not free to customize it. I'm actually also not free to distribute it and share it. So free to use is not open source at all. Not at all. Okay, Zoom is entirely proprietary. See, when you're using Zoom, you're using third-party servers. Zoom has got their own servers, and you are going to their server and conducting your meeting. All your data, all your entire meeting is hosted on their server. for Zoom, there are the free option, the open source option for Zoom. There is Jitsi and there's Big Blue Button currently in the market. And there would be plenty more that I'm not even aware of because, you know, programmers are. So for every closed source programming, there is an open source, not free to use. Not free to use. Free to use, Bhagwanji is not to be used. You have to go for open source. And you have to have that level of conviction and principle that you will not go for free to use. Or you use free to use and you say, it's not open source, but I'm using it just because I don't have any other choice.
Okay, okay.
NRICH.NATS, yeah.
Any idea on this?
No, I've not heard of it. Is it an open? I have no idea of this, NRICH.
I think the user is trying to ask whether this is open or not, but we don't have any idea.
So you have to go to the privacy policy of the website and clearly see that they will tell you this content is available for public domain use. It can be replicated in educational spaces. It is not for commercial use. You have to read the privacy policy of these websites before you start using their content. If you're only using it for your child as a user level, you can use content. But like in our case, if we are looking at putting it in our LMS, putting it in our learning management platform, we have to make sure that it is open source. You cannot just cut paste anything from the internet and use. That's clear violation.
Right.
Yeah. Saurabh, I'd like to just rattle off if you can make a list somewhere that they can see some of the things for 4 to 6 year old. I would like to send you some suggestions right now since he wanted options. So one is for OS, you can use Debian Ubuntu on your desktop. Okay. Is there any way to use a chat that people can see? Okay, I'll say. So for a,
you can put it in our chat. If you have the list, I can copy paste it on the comment section also. Or you can send me later. I'll just
run through them quickly right now.
Yeah.
Also, I am only one small open source practitioner. The amount of resources that are available, you know, even I won't even know all because there's so much out there. So to start with, instead of Windows on your desktop, switch to Ubuntu 20.4. Very easy, simple to download, simple to, you can download it from the net and install it on your machine and wipe out your Windows. Bhagwan, that's for first thing you can do. You can look at Debian, but Ubuntu is a consumer level open source software, lot of support, lot of features, lot of ability to handhold you if you're stuck. You can do dual boot, you can keep Windows and Ubuntu both. For the more advanced players, you can use Debian, you can use SUSE. There are, you know, there's lots of other open source OSs, but as I said, the consumer level popular one is Ubuntu. If you have a young child at home between 4 and 6, then there is TuxMath, TuxPaint. Tux is the Linux, is the penguin, which is a mascot of the open source world. So anything with that penguin means that whole space is open source. So we have TuxMath, TuxPaint. We have something called JCompris, G-C-O-M-P-R-I-S, which means I understand in French. It's got 100 activities for 2 years to 10 years. GCompris.net. It's also an Android app, though it's a better as a desktop. So those who have young children between, say, 4 and 10, it has very nice activities and games. GCompris.net, TuxMath, TuxPaint. Then there is something called the KDE environment, in which there are geography, there is JFractions, there is, Hangman, and so on and so forth. As I said, these are only, I'm just giving you a few examples of what we use. But if you go and type out on the net, open source games for kids, open source maths, open source tools, open education, you will get a lot. So I think for now, I think this is sufficient. Yeah.
Right. And even as far as I can remember, UNESCO has also recommended, you know, globally to use more and more open source education resources and also share about the
40 countries have ratified a resolution by UNESCO that says that in their countries, as governments of that country, they will only use open educational resources. So all these platforms that you see, Swayam and all of that, they're all supposed to be open educational. NCRT is supposed to be open ed. Diksha, if many of you use Diksha, which is the government of India's platform, is open source. It's supposed to be open source because even India's has ratified this resolution that we will encourage open source use against proprietary use. But the problem is that the market forces are too strong. And on the one hand, while the government says this, the advisors, the consultants, and the, you know, people in the government are all proprietary firms, and they are wielding a lot of weight. So textbooks of class 11 will talk about Microsoft Word, doesn't talk about text editor in general, but will actually talk about Microsoft Word, or will talk about Adobe PDF, but not, you know, readers in general. And there is a movement going on to oppose proprietary use of technology in textbooks. The student needs to know a text editor. Student doesn't need to know Micro. There are tons of text editors today. Even Google Doc is a text editor, right? So you can't say only learn Microsoft Word. But our textbooks are also redundant. So this is something that we, you know, need to just at least understand and try to imbibe in our day-to-day life as much as we can.
Right, right. So I think we have got a lot of information. Sharmila, you want to add to this anything? You have any question before we, I think it's time we can end up to this session, and whatever question we have, we can reply them on the comments. You are on mute.
Yeah. I had one question, which was about the whole thing around copyright. So, you know, I'm just trying to understand that when in open source education, or when a lot of resources are created, shared in a collaborative way, and anybody can edit and work on them, what is the entire take of open source education around copyright? Because then you can't claim it to be your own property, and you cannot claim any rights over it. So I would like to understand a bit about that.
No, so that actually has been taken care of by the Creative Commons movement. What the Creative Commons movement has done is they've released 6 licenses. Okay, in those 6 licenses, I have a choice. The license I talked about is the one that is share alike. It's called CC-BY-SA. When I say share alike, I mean I retain very little rights on it. And I don't mind if the entire homeschooling community takes this product and refurbishes and rehashes it. Only you have to credit me. That's all. So like this, there are 6 licenses. In some of those licenses, you can say that you cannot reuse and readapt. You can only do this. Some of them you can say you can reuse, readapt, remix, but you cannot. It's called an NC license, non-commercial. Okay, so all of the copyright issues are taken care of in these licenses. And the one I mentioned, the CC-BY-SA, is the most free. It's almost like a public domain license that anyone is free to use. But the remaining 5 have the stringent where you can control. Like attribution is necessary. You have to attribute Sharmila for this picture before using it. Otherwise, it's a violation. Or you can use my picture as it is, but you cannot derive anything from it. You cannot cut my head or cut this or cut that. So there are 6 licenses that take care of the copyright violation. However, having said that, you'll be surprised that sites like Pixabay, Free Images, Unsplash, these are all photographer-driven sites where photographers like Saurav are putting up their work in a Creative Commons web platform, where there is no money involved, but they are putting up all their beautiful artistic works for schools like us to download and use in our courses, entirely under a public, entirely under the CC-BY-SA. It clearly shows that this photograph is licensed under CC-BY-SA. Obviously, they are getting paid work through some other, through the publicity of this website. True. So a lot of artists, photographers who have been earlier very worried about this whole thing that how will I earn, how will I make money, what about my photograph, my film, my this thing. There are entire ecosystems where these musicians, where these photographers, where educators are releasing their content. But obviously, it's also from these same spaces that they're getting known. And then there could be a model of either donation, support, or saying that these pictures of mine are free, but for these pictures, you pay this much. And these are under restricted license. So it's a wonderful world out there, actually, with a lot of options. And the more you release your work, the higher the chances that you will get more work. If right. I'm saying, true. If you're worried about this copyright thing, and this is what open source has probably not been able to convince the rest of the world, that, you know, you aren't, by hiding, you are losing out. By releasing your things, you are gaining in today's world.
Right.
True.
Yeah.
But that's a philosophical thing that people need to understand. Yeah.
Yeah. Correct. So I think we can conclude to this session, because we have got a lot of information, and we can think on this. We can keep looking on, you know, open source, Creative Commons, all these things. So
sure.
Thank you so much, Michelle, for joining us today and sharing all your journey and about the OER. Sharmila, you want to add something?
So I think what she shared is so important for the homeschooling community. The use of technology, the use of open source technology, and not going in for proprietor-based products, and you know, to relook and question this whole thing about being a consumer. We have broken from the system of education, the current schooling system, and let's not fall into the trap of another schooling system on the net, but let's make use of everything that's available for us to, you know, collaborate with. So you're not only learning as a homeschooler, but you can contribute to its development. And I think that's the beauty of open education resources. And we must look into it, give a serious thought out on it. And Michelle is always there, I'm sure.
She yeah, can help sure, us, sure.
guide us. Yeah. And she's going to give us a whole list of, you know, resources that we can access and how and you know, the changes that we can bring in the way we use technology. She's mentioned a lot of it right away. So I think you've done a great service with this live session today, Michelle, and we really appreciate it. It's something that was much, much, much needed. And yeah, thank you so much.
Yeah, welcome. I think technology needs to be a constant discussion in the homeschoolers group. I think because of the way things are, I mean, this was just the start, but this whole business of how to use technology with kids, I think we should keep having some more sessions. Yeah.
Yes, definitely. Right. I agree to that.
Okay, then.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes,
thank absolutely. You. Thank you so much.
Yeah. So thank you everyone for watching, and if you have any question, if you are watching this you know, video later on, if you have any question, just leave your questions on the comment section. We'll come to that later on. So thank you everyone. Thank you Michelle. Thank you Sharmila. Next Saturday with someone special on our Saturday live. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.